Hi there, I'm Jeremy Krug, and in this video I've got some last minute reminders and tips as you get ready to take the AP Chemistry exam. If you haven't already subscribed, consider hitting that subscribe button, and if you like my videos, please slam that like button and share this video with an AP Chem student or teacher. It helps get the word out about my videos. Number one, when you write an essay, be thorough and don't cut corners. The exam will ask you to give an answer and explain yourself. When you do this, use the initials CER as your guide. That stands for claim, evidence, and reasoning. So let's say you have a question that asks you to state which has a greater ionic radius, the oxygen 1 negative ion or the oxygen 2 negative ion, and to explain our answer. So the first thing you want to do is give your answer. You'd say that the oxygen 2 negative ion has the greater ionic radius. Then you want to give evidence of why you chose that answer. In this case, the evidence is that although both ions have the same number of protons in the nucleus, the oxygen 2 negative ion has one more electron in its valence shell than oxygen 1 negative. Then you have to give the reasoning, or in other words, why should we care about the evidence? What relevance does the evidence have? That's the reasoning. So you'd say that having more valence electrons leads to greater electron-electron repulsion, causing the valence electrons to spread out more. You need to give all three. Almost every AP student can make a claim. That's the easy part. The evidence, well, most students can do that, but the reasoning, that's the part that seals the deal. So give all three of those, claim, evidence, and reasoning, on your AP Chem essays. Number two, significant figures. Make sure you use the right number of significant figures on your answers. Sometimes they have a question that specifically addresses significant figures. You might take the reading of a burette and estimate between the lines. Or the question might simply say, express your answer with the correct number of significant figures. On those answers, you've got to give the right number of figures. On other problems, you need to give a reasonable number of significant figures. That means that you look at the problem. If the problem seems to have numbers with 2 and 3 significant figures, give your final answer with 2 significant figures. Always go with the least. A reasonable number of significant figures means they give you a tolerance of plus or minus 1 significant figure. So if the answer is supposed to have 4 figures, they'll accept it as long as your answer has 3, 4, or 5 significant figures. Now, I've never seen them ask a question requiring more than 4 or fewer than 2 significant figures in an answer. So if you're not sure how many significant figures to use in your answer, just use 3. That way, you'll always be within the tolerance of the AP readers. Number 3. Use your calculator. On exam day, use the calculator you're most familiar with. Hopefully, you've been using a reliable scientific or graphing calculator every day in class, and that's the same one you want to use on the AP exam. You don't want to learn how to use an unfamiliar calculator on exam day. Change the batteries or charge it up before the exam. And remember that starting in 2023, you can use your calculator on both the free response and the multiple choice sections of the exam. Double check ahead of time to make sure your calculator isn't prohibited. Pretty much any general issue scientific or graphing calculator you use in school is fine. Of course, no cell phone calculators, no calculators that make weird noises or emit laser beams or look like computer keyboards. And one important detail about calculators, you are not required to clear the memory of your programmable calculator before the test. And I will leave it at that. Number 4, use strategy on the multiple choice section. The multiple choice section gives you 90 minutes to work through 60 questions. I strongly recommend you use the 3-pass method. On your first pass through the exam, solve the problems and answer the questions you know how to do. Then, on your second pass, you solve the problems you have an idea of how to do, but maybe you're not sure. On those questions, try to eliminate as many wrong answers as you can, and if you can get it down to two or even three possible choices, you have a really good shot at guessing the right answer. On your third pass, look at the questions you don't really know how to do and just take your best guess. If you have any time left after making all three passes, use the time to check your work on the questions you know and to keep thinking about the questions you weren't sure of. And whatever you do, don't leave any multiple choice questions blank. Even if you take a wild guess on a question, you have a 1 in 4 chance of getting it right. When I mention eliminating as many wrong answers as possible, sometimes there will be answer choices that are just ridiculous and can be easily eliminated. Take this question. When you read the choices, you can eliminate choice C because how soft an element is has nothing to do with its reactivity. And you might be able to eliminate choice D because you might happen to know that atomic mass has essentially nothing to do with reactivity, since you likely know that the most reactive alkali metals happen to be the heaviest ones. So if you can narrow it down to two choices, you have a 50-50 shot of choosing the correct answer, which is choice B. Number 5, units. Always include the correct units in your answers on the free response questions. Sometimes the problem will specify which units to use. If it says to express your answer in kilojoules, give it in kilojoules. Don't leave it in joules. You will not get credit if you leave off the unit. Remember, pH doesn't have a unit, and equilibrium constants don't have units. For pretty much everything else, if you write down a number as an answer, it had better have a unit next to it. Number 6, read the questions carefully. On some standardized exams, you don't really have to read the headers of the questions. The AP Chemistry exam is not like that. You have to read the questions and you have to read them carefully to understand what's going on in an experiment or figure out what the question is asking you to do. You can't ignore the header of the free response questions. Most of the time, those two or three lead-in sentences give you valuable data and other information that you have to use to solve the problem. I would recommend that before you jump right into a question, especially the short free response questions 4 through 7, that you take a minute just to read them and think about what they're asking. And number 7, carry through errors. One nugget of information you need to know as you work through the exam is that there is no penalty for carry through errors. That means that if you get the wrong answer for part A and then use that wrong answer as part of your calculation on part B, as long as everything else is right, you'll still get full credit for part B. So no penalty for carry-through errors. This is really important because some students look at an early part of the question and have no clue, so they leave the whole problem blank. Don't ever do that. If you have no clue on an early answer, you can always just make something up and move on, and there's a good chance you'll get plenty of points on later parts of the question. So, those are my last-minute reminders and test-taking tips for the AP Chemistry exam. And that's in addition to everything you'd normally do before an exam. Get plenty of rest the night before, have a good breakfast, have your pencils sharpened, wear a simple digital watch. If you've been working hard all year, studying, working problems, practicing, you will do fine on the AP Chemistry exam. Thanks for watching, and I hope you join me again soon or pass the word about my videos on to next year's AP Chem students. I'm not going to say good luck, because it's not going to come down to luck. You don't need luck at this point. You've got this.